Gentlemen, welcome to this first plenary of the day. Regulation for sustainable infrastructure. Regulation is an issue that came up yesterday at in almost all sessions. We have here three speakers: Madame Professor Emmanuelle Auriol, Monsieur Stefan Straub, and Michel Grupp. And then we will have Thomas Heller to have a general comment on the plenary. I invite Professor Auriol to take the floor.
So let me first thank Stefan and Marianne for putting this conference together. I'm really delighted to be here, and I must say I'm enjoying myself a lot. I'm not sure you are going to enjoy my talk so much, but that's okay. So I think it's very striking that we have only one session on regulation over 18 or almost session. And I think it reflects the state of the regulation literature today. And I would like to give you my view on why we are in the middle of nowhere in terms of academic production on this very important topic. And yet, it is still very important. So I've been working. Can I have the mobile mic? I'm a bit moving a lot, so I cannot stay to this. I need the clicker. Thank you. So this is, I had to produce a paper. So this is a joint work with Antonio Estash, who worked at the World Bank for a very long time, and Liam, who is a researcher at Paris School of Economics. And the title is Supranational Regulation. So I'm going to try to motivate why I think supranational regulation is relevant today, and it was not like 50 years ago, and why we need more research on this topic. Okay? What happened since the end of the Cold War is a massive restructuring of government. And this massive restructuring has took many different steps. One of the foremost has been globalization and market integration, which means you have to change the way you do stuff with other countries. The European Union is a very good example. And also to adapt to this new environment, there has been massive wave of privatization and outsourcing, especially in public utilities, in infrastructure. And this is we had a talk yesterday on the Washington Consensus, and the idea was that you should move from national monopoly to private firms that will provide infrastructure and services to the people. On the top of that, you have deregulation, because when you integrate with other country, you need to accommodate competition, which is typically the case in the EU. And so you move from public regulated monopoly to something which is either regulated oligopoly or even no regulation at all, and antitrust. And this is the movement that has been. And also you had, at the same time, decentralization reform, the emergence of independent central bank, which is very good, and fiscal erosion due to fiscal optimization by large corporation. So the bottom line is that at the end of this process that has been lasting for 30 years, we have a loss of sovereignty and autonomy of government. So the government basically has, national government have power of shrinking, and this has some implication, of course, for regulation, I think. So just to give you a glimpse of the privatization waves that swept throughout the world, so this is the end of the Cold War, basically, and the end of the 80s, the beginning of the 90s, and then you start seeing this massive restructuring, country after country selling public assets. And of course, if the public is selling assets, someone is buying, and who is buying? It's a private sector. So you have, this is a slide that shows at the world level, merger and acquisition. And so when you start to open the border, firms start to buy other firms to reach the consumer. And so they become international and much bigger. And so you have the weakening of the government, and you have the strengthening of private sector and private corporation. And so as you can see, and this is the end of the Cold War, and you have a surge in merger and acquisition. In fact, it has been one of the most intense episodes since the inception of modern capitalism. So this has consequences, and this figure show you what consequences we have. And so this is ranking a corporation by value added and country by GDP. This is perfectly comparable because GDP is the sum of all value added produced by a corporation or by firms. And you can see that some firms are bigger than very important government like a country, so like New Zealand. It's not some exotic island I'm looking at true country, and you can see that some firms in the world are bigger than this country, so not a government. So they have a lot of power, and in terms of course the financing and the way we produce public utility services and infrastructure, it means there's been a shift from the public financing of this infrastructure to the private financing of this infrastructure. And we have a lot of PPPs. It was mentioned yesterday in the introduction that 20% of all investment in developing world are made through PPPs. And I just put a bunch of them, but just to show you that it's not only in rich countries, it's also in developing countries that you have such way of financing things. So as an introduction, you see there has been a massive shift from public direct intervention towards more market-oriented type of intervention. So the problem is that the way we deal with market failure is very different in an open and in a closed economy. In a closed economy, it's fairly simple. You have a big firms because of increasing return to scale. You doesn't like what this big firm do, well, you nationalize it. And you control it directly. In an open world, you cannot do that. So you have, in a closed economy, national regulated monopoly. So you regulate entry, quality, price, and public ownership. In an open economy, you cannot work this way. So you have oligopoly, typically, and competition law. It means you regulate in very different ways. It's more light-handed and privatization. But we have some problem, especially for developing countries. In particular, antitrust authority are a joke in many, many countries, especially in sub-Saharan Africa. It's a desert, I mean, in terms of effective antitrust authority. So, and there are many evidence that show that international corporations are sharing market in sub-Saharan Africa. And when an antitrust authority in the US or in the EU find that out and has a proof of it, they can do nothing because their mission is to protect European consumer or US consumer. And so they let go. Another thing that is a problem is that to have some competition law or to have some oligopolistic structure, you need to have a competition in the market. And in regulated industry, market integration remains extremely challenging. And you still have increasing return to scale. I'm sorry, they are not dead. They're still, as long as we have infrastructure like distribution line or transmission line, you have natural monopoly for that. And it's mean you have incumbency advantage and difficulty to implement competition. So I'm really happy to talk just after the beautiful lecture we had by Catherine. But as an example for the idea I would like to push, I would like to look at the world electricity market. And what you see really easily on this graph is that Sub-Saharan Africa is an outlier. This is installed generating capacity, so it's an outlier. It's the only place on Earth, basically, where things are so wrong. And not only it's an outlier, it's also very patchy. You can see that you have close countries that have very different installed capacity, which show that there is no integration really there as a power market. So, same picture again. Sub-Saharan Africa is in the dark, indeed, at night. And so generation facilities are really limited, and it's mean that there is constraint of growth, although I agree it's very hard to prove that there is a causality or what is a causality between electricity consumption and growth. But also that it's about sustainable development. There is also an issue about pollution, because due to reliability issues, wealthy consumers big corporations or big firms in sub-Saharan Africa have generators. They all do. And so it's extremely expensive, the kilowatt, so it shows a propensity to pay for electricity, which is high, I think, and it's also very polluting. The other thing is that for the poor, they cannot buy generators, so they use a lot of other energy sources like wood or coal, and this is polluting too. So this is bad for certainly for pollution. And also it's a bit unfair because Africa is really endowed with many resource energy. So they shouldn't be in this situation, I think. And also one problem that is, and you didn't mention that, but that is put forward by technicians, is that increasing autonomy to scale are not exploited. So they are operating at a small scale. This is very inefficient because there you have a free lunch. If you increase scales, you can reduce the cost per kilowatt, which means that you can cover people for the same cost. And that will be, of course, an improvement. So what can we do when we are confronted to that? The idea is to integrate more the market. So there are some gain from integration. And typically, there is this project of big hydro electrical dam on the River Senegal or Grand Inga. We talked for them for years and years and years, and they never materialized. But there are good reason for that. They are oversized for one country. And so you need to interconnect different country if you want to make this this big infrastructure work. So this is a point for integration. Also, in an integrated system, you have it's cheaper to provide higher reserve margin, so increase reliability, avoid the shortage that we all experience when we travel in sub-Saharan Africa. The problem, you need to create an integrated market, which means huge investment, and especially in transmission. And this has, of course, a cost. So I just focus on sub-Saharan Africa because it's really an outlier in many, many aspects. But this idea that you should have integrated power market is all over the place in developing countries. And in fact, you have already many integrated power pools in other regions, in Asia and Latin America. What are the potential problems? Well, the problem is that in increasing to scale, you are not going to have an easy installation of competition because country will overprotect their national champion. And this is very natural because you are going to trade electricity, but you are not going to share the fiscal resources that came out of it or the lack of. And so because of that, it creates a lot of distortion in the way you will manage your national champion. And this will lead to some ambiguous effect. I will show you a picture in a second about that. You have also a big problem, I think, in the sub-Saharan African context, showing as a failure of regulation there, which is the fact that there are a lot of free riding on investment, and in particular, hold-up problems, and the fact that utilities, when they buy power from a neighbor country, they don't pay the bill. And so that's why they're disconnected very often. And so it's very important to understand all this problem if we want to move forward and to improve the situation in terms of power production in sub-Saharan Africa. What is sure is that laissez-faire as it is today, with the regulation as it is today, is not working. So just to show you, so this is based on a paper that I wrote a few years back, but just to show you the cost of integration when you don't have a supranational authority, when you just have two regulators that fight for their own customer and their own taxpayer, which is fair, they should do that. And so if you have no lambda is a measure of the fiscal cost, the opportunity cost of public funds. So if there is no concern about fiscality in this world, delta is a measure of the difference in generation cost. So if you are here, it's mean country two has a big generation cost, country one a much cheaper one. So there is a gain from trade. So as soon as you go away from zero, there is gain from trade. And so if there is no fiscal constraint, you win about when you trade. As soon as you integrate the fact that there are fiscal constraints, then it's not clear that you are going to win. You are going to lose when the difference in generation cost is not large enough. This is a bit like the Akerlof story. You need the gain from trade to be very large so that everybody benefits from it. Because here, the country are going to fight for the rent, and this fight is really unhealthy. So market and bottom line is market integration has really complex welfare implications in non-competitive industry. And so supranational regulation could be welfare improving because it could help solve this coordination issue, basically. So supranational regulation in this literature That, by the way, and the regulation literature was really booming in the 90s. Jean Tirole gets the Nobel Prize for the work he did on these topics in the 90s. And since, and this is why I say we are in the middle of nowhere, there has been not much literature. It has shifted the literature towards PPPs and public-private partnership. And what you read in the papers that deal with this issue of integrating power market, for instance, is that the solution should be the supranational regulation. So you add a supranational regulator, and this is the way this paper finishes, a bit like in a fairy tale where they live happily ever forever, and there is no explanation of how it is supposed to work or improve things. Huh? So we in the paper with Antonio Eliam, we try to look a bit at this problem of supranational regulation and what it could do in practice in the Lafont-Tirolean type of framework, because they are really the one who were the most productive in the regulation literature. And we try to understand a little bit better what are the costs and benefits of this type of approach, and the relevance also concern for other problems such as international arbitration. So we focus on the limitation of national regulation, and there are four types of them. I will go through that very quickly. This is the only slide. I was really forbidden to present the models, which is challenging for the type of paper I'm doing. So, but this is the only slide where you have some theory. What does this literature do? It looks at objective function from the government perspective that include different things. So the monopoly rent, so the rent of the regulated firms, the consumer net surplus, which is simply the gross surplus minus what they pay, and the taxpayer surplus. And as I was mentioning earlier on, you have this opportunity cost of public fund that play a big role in, and that's just to say that this country have huge fiscal constraint. They are not able to subsidize easily regulated activity. So on the top of that, you have a regulator who is supposed to collect information on cost, but we are in sub-Saharan Africa or in developing countries in general, so we can hide that for bribe. So there are limitations in the way regulation functions. It's not perfect. And the national government has an objective function, but it might be biased. It might put a higher weight and may be captured by the industry. So you can, in a fairly simple framework, and this is the only one I would show you, you can capture a bit all the trade-off that will emerge concretely with regulation. So gamma is a measure here of the capture, simply. If it increases, it means I put more weight on the profit of the firm than on the rest. Lambda is the shadow cost of public funds, so it's a value to be able to extract taxes from the industry rather than subsidize it. And xi is the probability that the regulator learns sika, the cost of the firm, so do his job right, and this is related to the capacity of the regulator agency. And k is the value of bribe, so it's a way to capture all the limitation I was mentioning. So what we can expect from supranational regulation that I said already, is not really studied, seriously, I think. There should be more. Well, we can hope that it will increase regulatory capacity. So if supranational regulation can improve the probability that the regulator is informed about the cost, so he can do his job better, that will be, of course, something we would be happy about. We could increase accountability, which is very important for the functioning of regulation, by affecting the degree of capture or the ease with which you can have bribes. Commitment is also something very important, and it's interesting because then you should do something different. So the weight you put on the industry, if it increases, it might be good for commitment because you don't expropriate them from their rent exposed, and so they are willing to invest. So it's a bit ambiguous where we should go there. And of course, if you commit more, you will have more investment, which is a big issue for instance, in electricity in sub-Saharan Africa. They are, for political reasons, they are not collecting bills, the prices, the tariffs are too low, and they are not able to invest enough. Finally, fiscal capacity. So you will have also a better, healthier financial situation if you have a better regulation, and so the transfer the government could make will be bigger. When I should stop exactly?
Have an additional 3-4 minutes.
Fantastic. Okay, that's good. So how, how can supranational regulation help to improve regulatory capacity? Well, the first thing is that by pulling together and putting together a regulatory agency at the regional level, so instead of at one country level, you can mutualize skills. Because, I mean, the devil is in the detail, but this agency exists on the paper, but they are understaffed. The people that work in this agency are usually underpaid. And so, of course, they are not able to do their job properly. So by mutualizing skills, you can really improve, I think, on the regulation you can get. You can also get an homogenization of auditing practice, and you can impose best practice on them. Okay. What is also very important, I think, and this is something I've been working a lot on, is about the collection of information that you can use to establish benchmark. And also yardstick competition. This industry, they have similar, they use similar technology, and so they have similar cost. And because of that, if you mutualize and collect information, you can really improve the management of the sector. And finally, you have less risky political interference. Also, what you can get is that the amount of lobbying you can show that firm will do to capture the regulator will diminish if you have a supranational authority, because there is a free riding issue between the different firms, which of course is good because we don't want them to lobby too much. And also, you want to have an international staff which are competent, hopefully specialist, and because of that, they will be, of course, much more able to resist to lobbying power or local capture by politicians and firms. And they can act, of course, as a referee, which is also something that matters for the effectiveness of the international regulation. So finally, we can also design the supranational regulation to protect firms, which is an issue because in developing countries, especially in sub-Saharan Africa, these firms simply are not viable because they don't collect bill and they underprice their services. So making sure that this supranational regulation takes the business at heart will help to solve this problem. And also, you have a lot of renegotiation that is not really renegotiation, which is expropriation, and supranational regulation can help to lower that. And so finally, also, by making the sector more viable, you can improve on the fiscal issue. So if you look at what exists on the paper, and this is like antitrust things, it looks very good. You have nice regional power pools, but you have to contrast this figure with the first one I show you, which is patchy, which show a lot of discrepancy between generation power by country. So this is what I think I agree that people like to tick boxes. And so when you do that, you tick a box. Okay, we have this regional power pool. They provide services. When you look at the practice in reality, it's just on the paper. They're understaffed, they have no power there. So this is not the reality of it. This is simply something that looks good on paper, I guess. So supranational regulation, as it is today, is not the panacea. It does not happen in practice. And what will de facto occur, what is already starting to occur, is instead of having an efficient supranational authority, you will have international arbitration courts that will make decisions to protect investor decision, and which is fine to protect investor because we need investment. But also, these courts are not regulators, and they are not very well equipped to integrate the concern of a national government. So there is a problem of sovereignty again. And there will be also a problem of capture, I guess, because we see that in the US. I mean, regulators are captured, and so supranational judges can be captured too, because the corporation, I mentioned that earlier on, are very large. And the international players are very large, yeah. And so clearly they can afford them to lobby much more than the government of Benin or Burkina Faso. So there are both cost and benefit in supranational regulation, but in the literature, that is, I repeat, in the a little bit stuck. There is no serious analysis about this cost. So I really think that maybe and there is an issue there to improve on the situation of the generation market, for instance, in developing countries, especially sub-Saharan Africa, with supranational regulation. But we need much more work on these topics. I mean, we have still public firms all over the planet. We still have increasing to-scale industry. We still have a natural monopoly aspect in the market. And we have basically no researcher working on how we should regulate them today. And I think this is a pity. So I hope some of you at least will look at this issue of supranational regulation.
Thank you very much, Professor Oriol. Are there any questions? Please, only understanding questions. It seems that it was completely clear. Thank you very much for that. And now, Professor Straub, please.
Yes, okay, maybe I'll use this. I'll keep this in just in case. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm very happy to be here. So this is joint work with Marianne and also my colleague David Martimore, who's at Paris School of Economics. And it's largely the product of a year that I spent here at the World Bank last year. I mean, it was a wonderful year. Many discussions that we had on a lot of different topics with people that are in this room. It's very good to be back. And one of this topic, one of this very important topic at the moment is this issue of private finance in infrastructure. And so as part of this discussion, we came to think that it would be good to put some framework on that. And in that, I have to agree with Emmanuel in the sense that there's clearly an underinvestment nowadays in the regulatory and in the theory part of research on infrastructure. We may have a comparative advantage in Toulouse on that part, and we're trying to contribute to that. And we also have some plans to do some empirical work later on. But this is the first product of this process. So it's about funding and financing infrastructure. And as you heard a couple of times, so can we adjust the screen to see all the things? I don't know how to do that.
I think you just have to do this. Oops, no, I don't know how to do that.
Is that this one?
Maybe not.
Okay,
oh,
yeah. That's good?
Yeah.
Right. So, I mean, the current policy narrative, and narrative is a very important word at the World Bank, as I learned last year, is that we should attract private resources to infrastructure. And there are many reasons for that. Some are very valid. First, there's an ideological trend since the 80s, you know, and the revival of PPPs and so on. Then there is this idea that, of course, developing countries have limited resources, scarce fiscal resources, a lot of debt, and often are not able to invest as much as they should. And on the other hand, partly for reasons related to current politics in the U.S. and elsewhere, concessional funds from multilateral and bilateral agencies and governments might be limited. So it's a lot about, there's a lot of talk about that. Oof, this is not working, sorry. What about this one? Yeah, this might be better, right? Okay, so this narrative takes a lot of different forms. One that we hear a lot is that we should generate a growing streams of PPPs to boost infrastructure investment levels. You hear governments in many places saying that, and we're going to save on public resources. The other one, which is very much in the air nowadays, is that there are these institutional investors out there. They have trillions of dollars that are invested in many different things. And if we could channel only a part of that to infrastructure, then we would solve all the problems of the world. And then the last one, which is slightly more sophisticated, and is this idea of blended finance. Maybe we can use public finance to actually crowd in private finance. And to some extent, that connects to the World Bank cascade approach that some of you in this room, I'm sure, know about. And I'm going to be very cautious when I talk about the cascade and defer to Marianne. But that's, I'll come back to that in the end. So this is the narrative. Here are some of the facts. So here I will have to disagree slightly with Emmanuel, at least on the numbers. Well, by recent estimates, PPPs represent less than 5% of the amount invested yearly in infrastructure in developing countries. Yeah, and so the 20% you mentioned that was mentioned by Laura yesterday is supposed to include investment by SOEs who have commercial finance, but we actually don't have good numbers on that, so we don't know. But about PPPs, it's about 5%. Depends, varies from year to year. And actually, half of this is public money. Something that people tend to disregard is the fact that a lot of PPPs actually have, I mean, the average is probably 40 to 50% of public money, either directly or indirectly in the form of guarantees. So you would double PPPs, which seems like a huge undertaking, and you would add 2% to global investment. Okay, we can discuss on the number, but it's not going to be 30% or 50%. So that's the first one. On the institutional investor side, I mean, there's a very interesting and nicely crafted paper by Indust and Stewart. Fiona Stewart is here at the World Bank. And they estimate under very optimistic assumption that you would take the 11 trillion assets that are under management of institutional investors. At most, 60 billion could be invested in infrastructure in emerging countries. This is less than 5% of global investment. So again, it's a small number. And finally, we started doing in parallel with this paper a couple of collection exercises. And here we have early results from Kenya. We've been talking about Kenya. Looking at water, energy, and transport, we have an exhaustive list of all the projects in these three sectors over 3 years in recent years. 100% of these investments were publicly financed. There was not a single project that got commercial finance, okay, including the project run by SOEs. So in fact, you see, like, private finance is a bit harder to mobilize than maybe we think. So we saw that it would be interesting to try to understand why there's not more private money flowing into infrastructure and how you would release this constraint if it's possible. We do that in a simple contracting model of infrastructure, a regulation model, actually, which I will try to present with like two slides, two equations out of 15 pages of model that will be difficult, but I'll do my best to convey the main intuition at least. And what we're doing is highlight the trade-off in terms of service pricing and coverage that is at the heart of this attempt to attract private finance. And we'll see that, well, there's no free lunch there. Okay, we can attract private finance in some cases, but what are the trade-offs? So first, I want to make a couple of things very clear. There are two related aspects, and in the discussions, we hear a lot of things that are confusing and are mixing up different things. First, there's the funding. So the funding means who is eventually going to pay for the cost of delivering the service. There could be full cost recovery, so these are users who are paying, or there could be no cost recovery and it's completely tax funded. There are other things like land capture and so on, but these are really the two extreme and the two main things. And then there's a cash flow issue in the funding, the fact that these are long-lived investment, and most of the time the funding comes gradually over time and is very backloaded. So you get the payment for the service only later in the life of the project. So that means that you have a financing issue, and the financing is the way you actually make sure that this cash flow that will accrue across the life of the project is mobilized upfront to start building and operating the infrastructure. So again, here financing can be fully public or fully private, and it can involve a large variety of instruments, budgetary expenditure, bonds, loans, equity, etc., all the possible financial type of instrument. One additional point that is very important, it's just a footnote. Discussions very often confuse private management and private ownership of assets with private financing. These are two different things. You can have SOEs that are privately financed that raise bond on private markets, And in China, for example, a lot of PPPs actually have private partners that are public. They are PPPs. You know? So, I mean, we tend to think that because we have a PPP and a private manager, this is privately financed. It might not be the case. As I said before, PPPs are often publicly financed. And finally, these two aspects are very interrelated. And that's also something that is very important. So funding, the way you fund, who pays, whether there is cost recovery, what are the type of pricing that you use, what's the time profile of cash flow, will have an impact on whether you can involve or not private finance. On the other hand, the fact that you might involve private finance, for example, may be instrumental in getting better monitoring, lower cost, better quality, and hence higher cost recovery. So funding and financing are completely interrelated here. So the mapping, of course, will depend on the characteristic of the sector. If we're talking rural electrification, I mean, there won't be a lot of cost recovery, obviously, as we heard in the previous paper, in the previous presentation. If we're talking rural roads, there won't be a lot of cost recovery. If we talk electricity in urban settings, maybe we have a higher level. And it also depends on political and regulatory characteristic of the environment and decisions on how to price services. Okay, so here's the model in like three slides. You have a public authority that wants to finance and build an infrastructure to provide a service. It may delegate part of the management and the financing. Forget about the management for now. Let's just talk about the financing to a private sector actor. There's a continuum of potential consumers who express demand for the service, and their demand varies according to the valuation that they give to the service. That's the V. And P is the price for the service. So the price is chosen by the regulator, and a consumer will buy only, the consumer will buy with probability 1 minus H of P, which is the demand function, if you want. It's aggregate demand for the service. If you price higher, less people are going to consume. Okay. You need an initial investment, and the cost is a random variable drawn from a distribution. So here's the first outcome. If you do traditional procurement, well, the firm has a break-even constraint. There are two things. The firm needs to invest I, gets a public subsidy, and gets a payment from consumers. Okay, so part of it is covered by a subsidy from the government, and part of it is covered by the fact that you actually have some level of cost recovery from consumers. They pay a price that is higher than the cost. Okay, and there's a complementarity, which is related to the fact that in the end, you can express the subsidy as in this way, just rewriting this equation. You have some type of Ramsey pricing in the background here. And of course, the optimal price is above the cost because there is some cost of public funds. So it's cost efficient to raise some revenue from consumers and not only from subsidies. Okay, that's a very basic traditional procurement. Now, there are two reasons why you may want to have private finance. Outside finance. The first one is that, well, maybe, you know, it's a large investment and the government doesn't have enough money to pay the subsidy. Or maybe the cost of public fund is convexly increasing in the size of the project. So if it's large, I mean, there's not enough resources, it would be too expensive. But second, and that's more interesting, outside financiers also have expertise that is not available in the public sector. So if costs are not verifiable, they can actually help making sure that the firm is not overstating its cost. I mean, traditional regulatory literature argument. So here we do it in a specific way, which is the costly state verification model that was first developed by Townsend, 79, Gale and Helwig. And we assume that these private financiers, they can audit the claim, they can audit the cost of the firm and make sure that the firm is not overstating its cost. Okay, and you need this audit to enforce the payment from the firm once you give the firm a loan. And then that's the last equation of them all. So I've just skipped you 10 pages of derivation. Well, you get a very similar thing, just there is a number of differences here. Because of the cost of auditing and the fact that the cost is not verifiable, you have to leave a rent to the firm. Oops. So you have to leave a rent to the firm, okay? Second,
the price is going to be higher than the price on the traditional procurement. Because of this rent and because of this cost of auditing the firm, you have to raise the price more than you would do under traditional procurement. And that also affects the cost, the virtual cost of the firm, which includes some of the auditing costs here. Okay. So part of the public subsidy is now dissipated and goes to the firm in the form of an informational rent. You actually use the private sector was more efficient in doing that to try to limit this rent. You know, the public sector would be terrible at doing that, but it's no way you can completely reduce this rent. Okay. So that's the principal result of the model. Okay. So here are the three takeaway, and then I'll try to highlight what's in my mind the main takeaway from that. So attracting private finance requires defining a combination of price and subsidy that is high enough. It's not like, oh, you do the same project as you would do and with a public subsidy, you set the same price and it just works. You have to set a higher price, and it also affects the subsidy that you have to give. You benefit from this comparative advantage that the private sector has in auditing the firm, so you can control this rent, but that means leaving a socially costly rent to the firm. And to limit this rent, you actually have to raise the price above the traditional procurement level, and therefore, and there we go to our development context, you have to exclude the poorest consumers, because you have this demand curve in the background. If you raise the price, less people are going to consume. The ones that are excluded are, by definition, the ones that have the lowest valuation, very often the poorest consumers. So implications in two slides, and that's to me, that will be the last part of the talk. Now, imagine we have this setting where we are in a low governance and unfavorable environment, and we want to implement this model. So we expect to have low budgetary capacity, maybe more tax distortions. Government rely on indirect regressive taxation. This means two things in the model: higher cost of public funds, lower quality of accounting standards, higher auditing costs. These are two of the parameters that are in the background of the model. Okay. So in this context, when these things increase, you actually have this paradox that at the same time, you need to reduce public subsidies more, you need to attract more private finance, but it's also becoming more expensive to do that. Okay, because relying on the cost of relying on public finance becomes larger, you have to raise the price more. You could add, and we have an extension in the model, the fact that, well, if the financial market is also less competitive and less efficient, this pushes this margin further up. Okay. Second, this happens in the context where it's actually exactly where you need cheap infrastructure the most. Okay, because demand is more elastic. For example, consumers are very poor, very credit constrained. They react very strongly to price increase. So Catherine didn't talk about this paper, but they have this other paper where they derive the demand curve for electrification, and they show that people react very strongly. If you actually set a price that is not even the full price, I mean, demand is basically zero. Okay, so you have these very elastic consumers there. So it's very hard to move the price above the expected cost to raise revenue from user fees. So it's where you need to do that the most that it's the harder to do it, actually. That's really the tension that you have here. So in some cases, and that's the case of Kenya, why do we find that in Kenya there's no private finance at all? Because the type of prices that you need to set to actually bring in private finance are just not feasible. You know, you cannot bring private finance to rural electrification settings. I mean, in this model, the trade-offs are just too extreme. So we expect projects in this type of context to rely on greater share, if not only public subsidies. So to sum up, and I have just two slides for 2 minutes, that's perfect. The main takeaway of this model is what? It's exactly in these fragile environments where you have a larger share of poor consumers to whom you want to extend the service that you would want to serve and connect to the service, be it electricity, roads, water, sanitation, you name it. It's exactly there that you need to raise the price more above actual cost and therefore restrict demand and exclude consumer more. So, and this tension between financial viability and inclusion to me, is really the fundamental challenge of infrastructure finance in developing countries. And that's the sense in which I said at the beginning, well, there's no free lunch. I mean, you know, you cannot just say, oh, you know, in these places where we don't have the access to public subsidies, let's just attract private finance, because this is there where the trade-off is more acute. And there's a huge cost to pay for that. And the cost is excluding consumers altogether. So that's the conclusion of the model. Let me just conclude. So the need to attract private finance kind of dominates the policy debate. At least it's a very, very recurrent aspect of the debate. But we very often put trade-offs, the real trade-off, under the carpet. What we show here is that attracting private finance where it's needed more is also where it's actually presenting more problems, because you would need to raise prices more above actual cost, restrict demand, and exclude poor consumers. And so that's where, and then I come back to the cascade thing, and Marianne will tell me or you whether she agrees with that. That's my understanding of the cascade logic. The cascade is not, oh, let's try to attract private finance whenever we can. The cascade in this context in Kenya is, okay, maybe what we need to do is do the best use of public money, which is try to use it to do reforms in the regulatory context, in the policy context, that would actually make this trade-off less binding, or try to ease the terms of this trade-off, so that at some point we can start bringing in the private sector. And maybe she will tell you about the case of Turkey, which I think they is an illustration of that. Last point, that's very nice, but it's not going to be a short-term process. So private sector is not going to be the silver bullet. Okay. Thank you very much.
Okay. Are there some clarification questions? If not, let's go ahead with the next one. Professor Michael Graham, please.
Do you have a presentation already loaded here? I don't think I see you.
I don't see it. Okay, just give me a second. Regulatory. Plenary.
Plenary. Sorry.
In the regulatory plenary, huh?
Oh, okay. This one, yeah. Presentation.
Whichever one was most recent.
This is the most recent.
Okay.
Right. Well, maybe just picking up Musa's comment earlier, which I thought was great remarks. This is very much a policy presentation rather than a research one. And it's partly at Marianne's request to talk about some of the UK electricity regulatory experience, policy and regulatory. So I guess my job is to try and explain whether and why it's of wider international interest. I'll try and do that, cover three main parts around evolution, reforms, specific electricity market reforms, and some of the lessons in the regulatory journey. I think part of the reason why this might be of international interest is the UK electricity system has been a bit of a laboratory in both regulatory terms since privatisation in 1990, but also in environmental terms, with quite a strong push to decarbonise, which has resulted in UK electricity-related carbon emissions halving over the period since 1990, and moving from what was then a coal-dominated system to one where coal is basically now almost phased out and will be dead within 7 or 8 years at most. And that is linked with the combination of policy and, to a degree, the regulatory dimensions of that. Now, I'm aware that we're actually already past the time when this session was due to finish, so some bits I'm going to take very briefly. I won't dwell on the wider regulatory history. Britain liberalised its system, said this is really the way to run a power system in the modern age. That led to quite a strong dash for gas, as it was known, in the 1990s, growing very rapidly, but based on private sector purchase power agreements, effectively long-term contracts with distribution companies. That model was what's now seen as a fairly classical sort of pool-based structure where companies bid into a national pool. We moved from that to a bilateral trading structure for various reasons. And still with a mantra that, you know, this was competition, this was the leading edge of competition. And I think quite a lot of international observers were a little bit shocked when they discovered the UK was actually talking about completely abandoning that kind of approach and moving to very fundamental reforms known as the EMR reforms that came into force in 2013. So I'm going to try and tell you a little bit about some of the implications, the rationales and implications, what's happened. Alongside that, a bit of a journey of the regulator itself in terms of duties. Initially, promote competition, then perhaps the classic formulation of protect the interests of consumers, and growing tension between the regulator and the government over the fact that that made the regulator very resistant to all this environmental stuff that the government was trying to push onto the system. And long debates that led to a modest but actually very significant change in the primary duty of the regulator being clarified that that term meant protect both present and future consumers, leading to quite a headache. And in fact, my role at the regulator was partly, what the hell does it mean to protect future consumers? Okay, so the background to the electricity market reform legislation was partly an enduring academic struggle between people who said, we've created a market, it should deliver what's needed in the most efficient way, including investments, versus others saying that is simply not how it's going to work in the real world. And I'll say a little more on that as we go through. But also to underline it, it was seen in the decarbonisation context, where UK had, by 2008, the Climate Change Act, which specified in primary legislation the need for an 80% reduction by mid-century in national emissions. The analysis said that means almost total decarbonisation of the power sector. That was seen to be basically requiring nuclear and renewables, capital-intensive sources. The transition this decade was estimated would cost around £100 billion of new investment. That was clearly beyond the pockets of the European and UK utilities. So the question of bringing in private finance absolutely came to the fore from outside the existing incumbents. And the political evolution was also rising energy prices, partly for external reasons. And institutionally, the Climate Change Committee, which was the body, advisory body set up under the Climate Change Act, said, we're not going to get the low-carbon capital-intensive investments that are required to deliver the Act. And the regulator also said, we're not getting the investment that's going to be required even to keep the lights on. So that was, the context. And it was, I think, particular shock Ofgem's position because it had been seen as the guardian of privatisation and liberalisation. But in essence, it said, well, in the real world, the proposition of the pure theorists was, well, you know, if we get tight margins, electricity price will go up so people will invest more. And if we're concerned about climate change, we should have a carbon price. In the real world, this came to be seen as a sort of the crude interpretation as a company had to go to the City of London and say, well, we want a couple of billion pounds to invest in a new capital-intensive plant. Well, to be honest, we're not quite sure what the electricity price will be. There may be scarcity pricing. We've no idea when or how frequently or how high. And there's supposed to be a carbon price. We're not sure whether governments will deliver it. And we don't know if they'll step in if the electricity price goes to politically unacceptable levels. But please give us £2 billion anyway. And it just didn't really work in terms of the risk approach of those expected to stump up the capital. To move on to what was in the reforms that came, four elements, contracts for difference, capacity mechanism, carbon floor price, and an emissions performance standard. I will try and crash through those quickly in the interests of time. They're sort of not as complicated as they look, but I suppose that's partly because I've been living this stuff for a few years. The contracts for difference is actually, despite the fancy name, a fixed price contract. It says you'll have a 15-year guaranteed government-backed contract at a specified strike price of electricity. The difference is we want you to get all you can from the wholesale market, which is the blue line here, and the government will underwrite the difference. If we have peak prices, then you pay the government back when that price goes above the wholesale market price. But it was basically to address the concern about investor perception of risk and bring in the most solid funding terms possible in terms of the guaranteed revenue providing you generated. And that was the technical risk was very much still with the private investors. What has been the consequence of this? Well, I think I can only say quite dramatic, particularly when the government moved from, in effect, negotiated contracts to competitive auctions. So what this chart actually shows is a bit of data for the most expensive renewable energy sources that we have at industrial scale in the UK, which is offshore wind energy. And it started out about £150 per megawatt hour. That was about three times the wholesale price. A lot of political tension, a lot of economics literature saying this is absolutely crazy. It's about the most expensive way you could think of to cut emissions. But just about, the government stuck to its guns. It then moved from those negotiated contracts to the first competitive auction, which there is the green line. And the green line's in the middle. My colleague at Cambridge, David Newbury, has used that as an argument of a natural experiment on how much does a long-term contract buy you in terms of reduced cost of capital. And his answer was about 3 percentage points. Now, if you're looking at a transition costing £100 billion investment, that reduction in the cost of capital alone is worth over £2 billion a year for 15 years. That's quite a big saving just from changing the contractual terms through which you are trying to bring in private finance to the system. But it's turned out that these contracts have done a lot more than that. And when, after a political hiatus, we came back to it after 2.5 years later, the second auction of 15-year contracts for offshore wind is the red line. And as one of the civil servants said, it was a total shock of the best possible kind. The fact that what we thought was just about our most biggest but most expensive resource actually has come down to contract price of 57.5. That means even offshore wind seems to have come down not far from the cost of wholesale electricity. And I think that was just like less than 2 months ago, and I think the entire political system is still digesting the implications of what's quite a revolutionary change in the perceived cost of renewables, due partly to the regulatory and policy structure bringing down the cost of capital and maximising competitive pressures through very well-designed auctions. That's obviously fundamental, incidentally. I should add there is one other very important thing in here, picking up actually Emmanuel's point, which is the other element here was supranational governance. The UK was signed up to renewable energy targets under the Renewable Energy Directive of the EU. They are legally binding, enforceable commitments on member states. They required Britain to get to 15% renewables, which implied 30% electricity. And the private sector was willing to bet that the government would not break European law. Even though if this had not been supranational, I'm certain the government would have abandoned the renewable energy drive. And it was used as a bit of a plank in the Brexit referendum, not a significant one politically, but it's like these stupid European renewable energy targets that have, quotes, been forced on us. Of course, it was Tony Blair that agreed. But so that's an interesting element. The second element, capacity market, I don't think I've really got time to go into much depth. This is a little bit more for the electricity geeks. It's fascinating for those of us involved. It was the answer to the challenge that, hey, we ain't going to get the investment to keep the lights on, even more with renewable energy when the whole system gets peakier and there's even less time you can recover the capital from the plants that provide the ultimate security. So the idea was to set up again, an auction system of contracts for firm power, again, 15-year contracts. It's market-wide. That was quite a strong debate, and it's a fundamental difference between the UK and the German systems, for example. The Germans pay for particular sources to be out of market but available in emergency. The UK system pays everybody for being available, whether or not you're existing, etc. Controversial, interesting, lots of bids emerged. The last one we had more than 10,000 megawatts of new plant, and the price has been about 30 to 40% of what we expected, so well under half the price that was expected, but controversial in terms of actually it went to small-scale stuff, which often turned out to be small diesel or other things, and the environmentalists said, whoa, wait a minute, that's not what we, you know, and others saying you're subsidising coal when you're trying to phase it out, it's all weird. The third element, carbon price floor, the government took the view that, you know, believed in the fundamental private market economics and decarbonisation, you have to have a price. The European carbon price was clearly inadequate. It added to the perceived investor risks. We had to have a price floor. The government would underwrite that price floor. The result of that price floor, combined with the other factors, improving efficiency and the entry of renewables, this is what's happened to UK coal burn. Last year, we had the first hours for more than a century without any coal generation. This year, we've had the first days for more than a century without any coal generation. Coal plants are closing left, right and centre, and the government has announced all coal will be phased out by 2025 at the latest. If I may, just one additional remark around the regulatory structure, which is this also spilled over into with the duties of the regulator. As said, it became lots of debate. Should it have an environmental objective, sustainable development objective? And it was framed, no, actually, we'll just clarify that we want you to think about future as well as present consumers. Ofgem had been very much dominated by an impact assessment process based on cost-benefit calculations, and yet it was faced by lots of angst, lots of problems around trying to do that in practice, which in effect meant they fundamentally changed the framework to have three components. One was the cost-benefit, one was the social and distributional consequences, and the third was the strategic and sustainability dimensions. And for a clear example, if you think about offshore wind, actually the fundamental argument was it's UK's biggest resource. We cannot meet the goals of the Climate Change Act without using our biggest zero carbon resource. Therefore, the regulator has to support the development of offshore transmission. That was a strategic choice, not a pure cost benefit evaluation. And they do have some differences. And if you tried to do it cost-benefit, basically what you did would become down to an argument that had nothing to do with climate change or future costs. It would really be about your discount rate. And the board was not interested in hearing economists arguing about the discount rate. So a simpler sense of where we're trying to get to. So that's sort of been in a very brief tour through history of UK electricity market reform. You can see there a few points about the process and implications. One remark is some of this, of course, was governments taking on the risk instead of private, which is how you bring down the cost of capital. Doesn't mean necessarily the risk has gone away, but the underlying principle is the people who take the risk on should be those best able to control it. The dominant risks in this system were concerning what governments will do around all sorts of issues, including carbon. And therefore, the argument was it makes absolute sense for government to take on that risk. And that, I think, has turned out to be a reasonable economic and certainly very effective policy position. You can see the remarks there. There was some brief discussion yesterday on transmission. We still have issues certainly to sort out there. And there are lots of outstanding questions. This, I think, has been a very interesting journey. I think, on the whole, a positive one, but it's certainly not the end of the road. There are still debates about the growing role of government coming back into the sector when they thought they got the government out of it. We're going to need much more time and locational specific signals and so forth. But I think I probably should finish the tale there in the light of time. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Questions? No, then leave some comments from Mr. Hill.
Yeah, I'll try and keep this very brief, and I'm going to sit here because I was up half the night. When I stopped being a professor, I suddenly found that the hours you spend as a practitioner may be on the phone in China or something of that source and that sort. And so let me just sit here for a moment. Here are the main messages, as far as I can see. Read these papers. They're each very good. They add a hell of a lot of detail, an enormous amount of which has been left out. Sometimes they're even almost good literature reviews of trying to understand these questions. They operate at very different levels. The paper Stefan was describing is a lovely theoretical paper about public and private finance. The questions of the transnational regulation is a bit more contextual, not strongly empirical, because as was said by Emmanuel, you can go into these things in the European case or the Asian case or the American case, but there is a good deal there. And when we come to Michael's work, we see that in the context of substantial technological change, price change, and change in policy objective, as the UK has been through in the 1990 and then the 2013 reforms, if you have one regulator, leaving aside the EU for the moment, looking to the future of the UK, the task is extremely difficult. And if there is a single message, the answer of each of the paper is, well, it depends. Or the devil's in the details. And the question of how you organize the financing of the electricity sector. I think it's an argument for three things going forward, well situated by the theoretical or the empirical work that has been presented here. The first is we need to do empirics. I mean, Catherine started out the day with that. We really have to do empirics in order to understand what's going on. Secondly, I think political economy matters. That has been said by others in this conference, because you are working within institutional histories. And those institutional histories and practices, both public and private, really constrain the way people conceive the answers that are necessary in response to change. And I think the third thing, which was stressed a little less, but I tend to stress a great deal in my own work, is we are increasingly working under multiple growth models. That is to say, the growth models, development models, or macro models that we are experiencing with great constraint around the world at the present time, whether we're in the advanced industrial economies, the so-called emerging economies, or the less developed economies that have often been discussed in this conference. As those things change, much of the question of financing infrastructure turns out to be a question of the scarce allocation of capital that demands not just the sustainability dimensions, but the productivity dimensions to creep out of the macro torpor, the slowness that we find ourselves in, certainly in the developed world since, I think now people would say 1973 with a few bumps, but in the developing world, certainly since the financial crisis 2010-11, and the changes that have been experienced. So let me just make a few remarks about these different questions. I'll start with the paper that Marianne and Stefan did, a very good paper. It really pays to pay attention to the questions of the difference between funding and finance, as they said. Who pays up front and how do you collect the revenues from public and private entities to pay off those financed commitments. Both turn out to be public and private in most systems around the world. If there is a more defined edge of the spectrum, it is much more a Chinese-like case around the world, where they are all, in practical purposes, public, both finance and funding, than it is that you really see true privatization in the sense that many economic models tend to assume. But these two are certainly linked in a strong way. If for no other reason, then funding is about who pays, how much, when do they do it, how long can we expect them to keep it up and under what conditions and what are they buying. But those things really depend on the set of policy structures that are put in place in market design and the adaptations to that market design. So it turns out that both that the funding issues are very much related to the policy issues, and therefore, in a sense, the policy which shapes performance, the business organizations, whether public or private, SOEs or utilities or distributed generation models, are all very much impacted by the policy. In a way related to the funding, and at the same time, they define the set of risks that need to be financed. And in defining those set of risks, they essentially start to define the set of actors in the financial system who have a preference at an organization such that they can take those risks. So recently, we did a lot of work in connection with the Energiewende, the second part, the change in the energy laws in Germany, looking at not just the changes in policy that were being proposed that very much related to those funding questions, but in particular, how that changed the set of risks that were out there and who could take them. And looking at the pattern that existed with the land banks, which are public banks at the state level, and how they passed the money on to Dresdner and Commerzbank and the so-called private banks who actually distributed it, and how co-ops operated. If you are financing onshore versus offshore wind, there are completely different groups in the society who are willing to amass those kinds of capital and take those risks. So finance and policy really can't be separated. And what we find when we look around the world is there are many organizations in the public sector who do both, in effect. Giuliano, my colleague at CPI, is here from Brazil. Band S, the National Development Bank, certainly provides subsidy to contribute to the funding, but it also is the principal financer, certainly on the debt side, for all infrastructure in Brazil until quite recently. The People's Bank of China is offering discount windows now for green bonds. That is a funding issue. At the same time, it is setting the regulatory terms. Even if we talk about the IFC and blended finance, it's a scarce resource that is available in what is called the market rate lending or the commercial lending of these banks. If it's a scarce resource, you have to allocate it. There are some features of these banks, maybe related to enforceability or their capacity as repeat players collect on debts that are owed. So in all of these cases, I think that the institutions cut across this gap, and the complexity can get extremely severe when you start to really look at the institutional maps. We are running different financial systems around the world. We have multiple publics and privates. The publics are divided into multilateral banks that are transnational, national development banks, budgetary actors. We find the privates divided into public and private into domestic and international or cross-border actors. I spent 12 years of my life litigating a case on what was then the biggest power plant in India, the Dabhol case. I had multiple regulators at both, because it's concurrent jurisdiction. The generation and the off-takers were both state and private in both cases. This started in 1992 and ended in 2004 or 5. And finally, I had state and private funders involved in these structures. And yet it turned out that what really mattered most for the risk structure and who covered was stuff that we really didn't think through enough in this, which had to do with the bankruptcy law and how long you could stay in court and could you collect from your insurance here at MIGA or in OPIC when you hadn't exhausted your judicial remedies in India, which is probably impossible when you really begin to look at it. So it's a very large institutional complex. Now, 3 points and I will stop. First.
Tom, I'm sorry.
You want me to stop now?
If you could, because
I'll tell you what the points were.
But the problem is it's already 11:30. I was hoping we'd stop at 11:30 and just a 15-minute coffee break. Bruno, I'm sorry to overstep, but could we just have a bit of a poll? Would it be okay to ask the presenters questions over the coffee break? Or are there some burning questions that you would like to ask quickly right now? And then I'll give it back to Bruno. No? Okay. Bruno, I'll let you conclude the session.
You have already concluded. So have the break. Let's have the break. Thank you very much.